Well, we have a blessing tonight, and that is our message being given by Fred Scott. Fred and his wife, Janelle, serve as a shamash, or deacon couple, here at our congregation. Fred is currently the director of facilities management at USC Upstate. He's also an enthusiastic student of the Word of God, always trying to better understand the Jewish roots of his New Covenant faith. So I would ask you to join me as we give a warm Greenville, South Carolina welcome to our own Fred Scott.
I'll read every other page tonight. Shabbat shalom. It's very good to be here tonight. It's good to see new faces and old faces, although I probably shouldn't say old faces, but I look in the mirror and I see at least gray hair and a gray beard. But it's really good to see you in a green notebook. So when I think about Shabbat and I think about sliding into a Shabbat, I'm always grateful to be here. Somebody might say, how was your week? And I'll say, well, I'm glad it's Shabbat. So, the kid, yeah, reminds me of a story. I love baseball. And so around 12 years old, I played third base. I was a starter, and I think I had a better bat than a glove. But I went to see the Atlanta Braves with a buddy of mine, and my dad took us. And it wasn't so much I wanted to see the Braves, but they were playing the Cincinnati Reds. And my favorite baseball player was Pete Rose. And so Pete Rose, they called him, I think, Charlie Hustle. Is that right? Charlie Hustle, my historian buddy over here. So he was an amazing baseball player. So he gets up to bat, and it's a really close game, and he hits a ball deep in the right center, and it's in the gap, and he is stretching it out to third base, and he goes diving in. If you've ever seen a picture of Pete Rose diving, I think he's probably 3 feet off the ground. He goes sliding in almost from shortstop. There's dust everywhere, and the ump comes up, safe! And then the other coach comes out, no, he got him in a tag, he's got him, but he was safe. It's kind of like Shabbat. I feel like Hannah, I just slid into Shabbat, and I've had that kind of week maybe sometimes. So there's my funny story for tonight. But it's really good to be here. God tells us not to forsake the congregation because we need each other's support. We need prayer. Rabbi Todd, he always has these prayers that really are uplifting, and he thinks about so many people. And I'm thinking about the difficulties over in Jerusalem right now. But for now, three things last: trust, hope, love, and the greatest of these is love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13:13. Adonai said to Moshe, go to Pharaoh, for I have made him and his servants hard-hearted, so that I can demonstrate these signs of mine among them, so that you can tell your son and grandson about what I did to Egypt and about my signs that I demonstrated among them, and so that you will all know that I am Adonai. Moshe and Aaron went into Pharaoh and said to him, here's what Adonai, God of the Hebrews, says. How much longer will you refuse to submit to me? Let my people go, as they can worship me, so they can worship me. And that's in Exodus chapter 10, verse 1 through 3. I won't read the entire portion. I always joke about that. But this week's Torah portion is called Bo, and it means go, or in some translations, come. And so from the first sentence of this week's Torah portion found in Exodus chapter 10, verse 1. And another story, it reminds me of a high school friend of mine, Bo Wise. He was a little bit shorter than I am, but he was feisty, and he was strong and lightweight, and he was an exceptional wrestler, Rabbi. So he did not lack confidence. He reminds me a little bit of this Torah portion today. As I called out Bo or Go, maybe because Moshe, in that Exodus chapter 6, verse 30, comes across as a lightweight. And he's like, I don't know if I can do this, Lord. Kind of like me, maybe. I stutter with my words sometimes. But this week's portion reveals another side of Moshe. I don't know if when you read the portion of Moshe, you realize his confidence grows. And God just speaks through him. He does mighty and wonderful things, keeping in mind that he's 80 years old. So toward the end of this week's Torah portion, we read that Moshe did what Adonai commanded him, and signs and great wonders of God were demonstrated. But later in chapter 10, verse 27 through 28, we read, but Adonai made Pharaoh hard-hearted, and he would not let them go. Pharaoh said to him, get away from me, and you had better not see my face again, because the day you see me, you will die. Moshe answered, well spoken. I will see your face no more. That's a rather bold statement, I think, to the most powerful leader over a very strong nation. So by the time of this week's Torah portion, seven of the 10 plagues have already occurred. And now we're about to read about the remaining three: locust, darkness, and death of the firstborn. Talked about darkness being so thick you could feel it. I've been hiking in the mountains. I love to walk in the woods. I love to walk in the mountains. And I've been to a place called Howard's Knob, and it would be so quiet up there. It's almost deafening. That seems strange to say, so quiet it's deafening. But it's just so quiet and peaceful. I can really enjoy that. So I can't imagine the darkness that was there, except in the Israelites. They had light. This Torah portion is about Pharaoh having a hard heart and God demonstrating his signs and wonders in order that you will all know that I am Adonai. God wanted to reveal himself. Over and over after the plagues of afflictions occurred, Pharaoh asked for forgiveness, asking Moshe to pray for relief. Please give me some relief and I'll let your people go. But after he let them go, his heart was hardened again, even more so. He refused to let them go. By this time, even his servants were begging him to let them go. In verse 7, the Israelites were all going to leave this bondage to Egypt, including their livestock, and Pharaoh must have known that. He must have suspected as much. So every time I read about the plagues, I can hear in my memory the tubas and French horns playing in the action sequences of the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston, and hearing the Egyptians crying out and Yul Brynner just looking out in stoic silence, the display of his confidence in himself, an expression of his hard heart. I looked at the video, the short clip of it this week. It took me way back. So who else watched that on TV? A few of you laughed and smiled a bit. Well, as a Gentile, I may have a different perspective on the Torah portion than others who were raised differently than I was. At the time, I didn't know what a Torah portion was, but I do now. And I want to know more. Like Rabbi Todd said, I really want to know more, and I want to dig deeper. And I appreciate my brothers in here who encourage me, and I encourage them that we can talk about the Torah portions. Well, often we'll do that at Oneg after the service tonight. So let's dig in a bit more, perhaps from my perspective of understanding, but keeping in mind there's no substitute for reading Scripture yourself. We read about the plagues more than once in Exodus today, and again we observe in Pesach in our Seder when we read about the club of plagues, all 10, blood, frogs, lice, swarm of flies, cattle, diseases, boils, hail, locust, darkness, death of the firstborn, as we were instructed to teach our children and our children's children never to forget what God did for the Israelites and ultimately for us today. So as a reminder, keep watching the webpage for updates. I think in early April we'll have our Seder, but don't listen to me. Keep watching and we'd like to invite you all to attend the Seder. It's a fantastic time. It's a great time to honor God and fellowship and be obedient to one of his mitzvot. The Torah portion finishes with the firstborn males of Egypt being killed by Adonai, both humans and animals. God had made the Egyptians favorably disposed toward the people, giving to them vast treasures as they left Egypt. And that was prophesied. And Moshe was regarded as a great man in Egypt, which was a fulfillment of what God had told him beforehand. Maybe Moshe doubted, but God says what he means, and he means what he says and does what he says. And we can count on that, and I'll say that over and over today. We can count on him. So God gave the people of Israel instruction on how to keep Pesach and to set aside their firstborn from the womb after they entered the land of Canaan, as we read in Exodus chapter 13, verses 15 through 16. When Pharaoh was unwilling to let us go, Adonai killed all the firstborn males in the land of Egypt, both the firstborn of humans and the firstborn of animals. This is why I sacrificed to Adonai any male that is first from the womb of an animal, but all the firstborn of my sons I redeem. This will serve as a sign on your hand and at the front of a headband around your forehead, that with a strong hand Adonai brought us out of Egypt. So perhaps some of you are wondering why these things occurred. Why did it happen this way? Was it necessary? I find myself asking why too many times, and I should not. I should just simply read God's word and just seek him. But I find myself asking why. I work in facilities management. And I'm like, why did that break? How can we prevent that from happening again? It's called preventative maintenance. And so I want to know why. So it carries over when I'm reading scripture sometimes. So I'll blame it on that. So in our business life, and especially if we're watching current events, that's really tough to watch. I want to see the news, but I don't want to see the news because I don't want to get worked up about my opinion versus their opinion. But the information that's supplied to us, we can quickly lose our focus. And sometimes I do that. During COVID and during just things that are happening, I lose my focus. And I'm thinking about a buddy of mine who said, it's kind of like in football, which I played a little bit of football. But the guy's on defense, he's trying to get you off sides, and he's just getting you confused and getting you, you forget about the count, and you're jumping off sides, and he's just smirking at you. So it's just a matter of keeping your mind focused on the first things first. So we can too easily get caught up in our opinion versus their opinion, motives versus their motives, and asking when this cycle will end. It can become a bondage because we cannot change a thing. We can't even seem to change ourselves, much less the world, to make it a better place. But let's keep reading, as John would say here. He used to sit right over there. About 1,500 years after the Exodus, Yeshua quotes scripture to deal with temptation in Matthew chapter 4, verse 10, also referencing Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 13. Away with you, Satan, Yeshua told him, for the Tanakh says, worship Adonai your God and serve only him. He not only quotes scripture to deal with the adversary, but he is also telling us to live out our faith in Matthew 5. To understand and do what God instructs us to do, to choose life. Love God and love our neighbor. We will always have hard times, even trials and tribulations in our life. We'll have the poor. We cannot escape any of this, but he wants to be our strength, similar to the Israelites exiting Exodus, finally free from their captivity. There will only be words to us if they stay in our mind, and if we don't embrace them with our actions. But let's keep reading. Yaakov, or James in English, says in chapter 1, verse 2 through 8, regard it as all joy, my brothers, when you face various kinds of temptations, for you know that the testing of your trust produces perseverance. But let perseverance do its work, its complete work, so that you may be complete and whole, lacking in nothing. Now if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in trust, doubting nothing, for the doubter is like a wave in the sea being tossed and driven by the wind. Indeed, that person should not think that he will receive anything from the Lord, because he is double-minded, unstable in all his ways. This is often when I look at my shoes sometimes. My wife and I like to read Proverbs a lot. And sometimes I'm thinking of other people, and often I'm thinking of myself. I need to really embrace and let it just get into my flesh, get into my spirit, and let it rule my flesh. So James later goes on to tell us in James chapter 2, verses 18 through 24, but someone will say that you have faith and I have actions. Show me this faith of yours without actions, and I will show you my faith by my actions. You believe that God is one? Good for you. The demons believe it too. The thought makes them shudder with fear. But foolish fellow, do you want to be shown that such faith apart from actions is barren? Wasn't Abraham Avinu declared righteous because actions when he offered up his son, Yitzchak, and on the altar? You see that his faith worked with his actions. By the actions, the faith was made complete. And the passage of the Tanakh was fulfilled, which says, Abraham had faith in God, and it was credited to his account as righteousness. So my good friend and I were talking the other evening about God's discipline on our own lives, in our lives, as a result of our actions sometimes. And I think Rabbi Todd talked about that a little bit earlier as well. But I used to ask my kids when I needed to discipline, I'd say, what's another word for discipline? And they'd say, love. Because God loves, he disciplines those that he loves. I think we shall never arrive at a point where we're there and we've succeeded in what we'd like to accomplish until we get to heaven, of course. So in the interim, it appears that we must always demonstrate our trust and obedience in the midst of hardships. And we read in Matthew 4 that Hasatan quoted scripture in an effort to tempt Yeshua. And we read in James 2 that the demons believe too and shudder with fear. So sometimes I think of that. It's not enough for me to believe. I must take action. I must embrace this. I've got to demonstrate and act out my faith. And I need to come together with you guys and fellowship and worship God. I felt like we could have probably gone home after we sang that last song just a minute ago, just worshiping God and just inviting his spirit here. So some historical references, maybe for new or up for further debate. The more I've started to study history in college because I really enjoyed it, and my buddy over here likes it as well, but it's like so many theories, there's so many different ideas and dates, or this date or that date. Of course, we don't know. We weren't there. We didn't observe it. But Egyptian current events I'm going to take a stand here and just say this may be some accurate dates. Egyptian current events around the year 1700 BCE include worshiping numerous gods, the so-called deity of Pharaoh, construction of amazing architecture, which I enjoyed, writings, empire expansion, and embalming, among other things. So how many years did the Israelites live in Egypt? 430 years. Well, I vaguely recall my college history classes and read some material in the timeline with multiple variations for a study, so I'll suggest these. These we do know in Scripture. Joseph was 17 when he was taken into captivity, and he estimated around 1704 BC, and he was 110 years old when he died. Pharaoh, I'll trip over this name, Amenhotep III, may have been the ruler of Egypt at the time of Joseph. Archaeological scholars tell us that he brought Egypt to a peak of economic prosperity. Interesting. A system of irrigation was developed, and 156,000 acres of land was reclaimed for agricultural use. Construction included palaces, temples, towns, a pyramid, and large statues called colossi. Janelle and I talk a lot, my wife, and I'm always wondering, what did the cattle eat when they were in the desert? I'm thinking about the facility side of things, so if you guys will bear with me, I hope someone is enjoying part of this as well. But Israel lived in Egypt, like we said, like we read in Scripture, 430 years. A period towards the end of life became extremely difficult to the point where they cried up to God for relief. So Moshe, when he was in Egypt during the time of the Exodus, around 1504 BCE, I've not found a satisfactory explanation for the discrepancies in the numbers and the years, but maybe we can talk about that a little bit more in Oneg and we can compare notes. But so maybe this is why Indiana Jones movies were so fun to watch back in the day, the intrigue of the historical discovery. So Pharaoh Tutmos may have been ruler of Egypt at the time of Moshe. Could this be the same one that Steve Martin memorialized in his song? I'm not sure. Who wants to sing that one? Scholars have suggested that Tutmos had a short reign that ended abruptly and lacked significant monuments to memorialize himself. Just not enough time to design, bid, build. So are there any architects or engineers in the room? Just not enough time to put it together. So not much is really known about him. He quelled a few rebellions. No major monuments, and some that were built, they were torn down by other ones, but his mummified remains, this is what's interesting, were discovered in observations by a British explorer, I believe, and exhibited scarred skin, possible evidence of plagues. Mm-hmm. After his death, his wife, this one I studied in college, and I can't still pronounce her name, Hatshepsut, also of royal descent, became co-regent with Pharaoh, where she did have large monuments constructed. And many of you history scholars have seen pictures of her temple. It's an amazing structure, and it's amazing to me that it's still there, and you can see that today if you went to Egypt. I find it intriguing to consider that Tutmos II to appear to have troubled and short reign. It really, it's really interesting about historical. I read a lot of times news from Israel, and there's a lot of archaeological discoveries, and it's just proving the accuracy of Scripture, and I enjoy that. I think that's fascinating to me. Not that I need to be convinced, but I just find it fascinating. I'd love to see part of that. So perhaps in a further debate, we can talk a little bit later in Oneg. So they worshiped numerous gods, and they called the so-called deity of Pharaoh. The people of Israel were exposed to the Egyptian pagan worship, which surely had a negative influence. My wife and I have talked about that, the influence and maybe the struggles that they had when they were in the desert. Maybe wanting to go back. Why would you want to go back when you cry to escape? There's a comfort there. We don't know how they felt. You know, it's easy to, as we like to say, the Monday morning armchair quarterback, hindsight's 20/20. But it may have had an influence on them. But God had plans to reveal himself. With mighty signs and wonders to lead them out of bondage into the promised land because he heard their cries. God wanted to make himself known to the world. Now I'm thinking about Yeshua's ministry too, and first when he was quiet about his miracles, and then later boldly confronted a stiff-necked leadership. It was time. It was time for him to reveal who he is and why he came to this earth. Go back and read about Yeshua and what he did. In upcoming Torah portions, we'll learn more about the journey towards the land of promise. the covenant land that God promised to his people. We'll talk about parallels to the New Covenant Scriptures, so please join us every Shabbat. We meet every Friday night, so you guys come back. For those of you, this is your first time, we welcome you back. So let's consider some encouraging words today. What do we know and believe about our relationship with God? Consider these statements. History teaches us a lot. Hindsight is 20/20. We have heard and experienced testimonies of answered prayers. And answered prayers are very interesting. You know, when you're praying with someone who's sick, you know, you're not sure how to sick. But we know that God is more than able to heal. But we know that he's here. So at the end of the day, I'm thinking, if I have a relationship with God, it doesn't matter about anything else. That is the most important thing to me. There's a shalom that overcomes. So God's word provides us wisdom through the reading of his word in the Bible and the hearing of his word. We have scripture, God's written word. Our conscience is guided by the Ruach HaKodesh. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13, David has the Spirit of the Lord on him. In John chapter 14, verse 15 through 17, Yeshua tells us that he will ask the Father and he will give us the Spirit of truth. I will testify to you today there is power in what he gives us. Power to give us confidence, but I think foremost, shalom. I think I have water up here. So why do we struggle? So Paul tells us in Romans chapter 7, verse 12 through 16, that he also struggles with doing good in relation to Torah. Towards the end of the chapter, he thanks God that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, will rescue him from his body bound for death. So let's keep reading. Sorry, I'm reading this. What does our relationship with God look like? How do we react to life situations when all is going really well? The downhill stretch. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 11 through 14, we are warned to be careful not to forget about Adonai, but not by not obeying his mitzvah. Otherwise, after we have eaten and are satisfied, built fine houses, and increased our wealth, we may become proud-hearted. So how do we react in distress? We've heard the old saying, there are no atheists in a foxhole. I read this goes back, I think, to an article in a British newspaper in 1914. The writer said, tell the territorials and soldiers at home they must know God before they come to the front. If they would face what lies before them, we have no atheists in the trenches. Men are not ashamed to say that. Though they never prayed before, they pray now with all their hearts. I could not find the author's name to give that person credit, but I think it's pretty strong. But in Scripture, we can read in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, to not be afraid. We can ask Rabbi Todd later, how many times do not be afraid is in Scripture? God is with us, and he will give us strength, give us help and support with his victorious right hand. I like that, his victorious right hand, and that's a fact. So what is it like in history, and can those times relate to us today? Of course. In the parsha today, we read about plagues, prayer to stop the plagues, and a hardened heart. Does that sound like something we recognize today? Is there a parallel to consider? Well, join us every Shabbat service, and let's learn more about God together. Later on, when the Israelites were in the desert, we read about fear and doubt, rebellion, and intercessory prayer. Does this sound familiar to you in the midst of these current events? In 2 Chronicles, the people of Israel were told a pivotal monument, a moment in history, to not fear, for the battle is the Lord's, and to trust in Adonai your God, and you will be safe. To trust in the prophets, and you will succeed. Could this promise apply to you today? Yes. While some scripture, I think, is time or people-specific, I believe the principle applies to us today, that God's faith is faithful to his word and that he loves you. During World War II, our history buff read accounts of General Patton praying in the midst of a terrible storm for fair weather and success the evening before the Battle of the Bulge, and fair weather ensued. And I think that guy got a promotion. I'm not sure, but he did in the movie. And later, as the Allies further advanced into Germany, they discovered the horrors of Jewish concentration camps in Germany. So I'd like to say, let's take a short moment to just pause and pray in silence for International Holocaust Memorial Day today, January 27th. So many have sacrificed so much, and to God be the glory. Do you know of anyone who fits that description? In Israel today, we read about attacks from all sides, lies expressed, condemnations, who really owns the land, anti-Semitism, threats. Today we read about murders in Jerusalem. We may even experience similarities in our lives. So we can step in the gap. And like Rabbi Todd did tonight, we can continue our prayers for the peace of Jerusalem and salvation for God's Jewish people. And may it come speedily without delay. Amen. Mm-hmm. Considering our current events, how did we get in this situation? What happened? From a perfect relationship with God in the Garden of Eden to disobedience, an introduction to sinful actions. Can we relate? From bondage in Egypt and the Exodus for deliverance to dishonoring rebellion in the desert. Can we relate? Through building the city of Jerusalem and construction of the temple to honor the Most High God, then to disobedience and diaspora. And now to the current restoration of Israel, prophecy being fulfilled. Amen. Rabbi Todd speaks a lot about the restoration of Israel and what is happening. Prophecy is coming true. So really come back and visit with us again and enjoy some of the teaching that Rabbi Todd brings to us. There's so much study to learn about biblical prophecies coming to fruition, historically and even currently in our days. God has given us opportunities to seek Him and find Him, to be tested and increase our faith, to accomplish the tasks set before us, because each of you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Mm-hmm. Have you ever wondered about your purpose? Why am I here? God created you for His kingdom purpose that He will accomplish only through you. Last week, Rabbi Todd talked about the scripture reference of the potter and the clay. And I'm not sure if this is the scripture you referenced, but in Isaiah 45, 9 through 12, I found, we can know His good plan for our lives. However, we are just going to have to invest in the relationship that God wants us with us. I didn't quote that scripture. I'm reminded of a movie line that makes me smile. Come on in, boys. The water's fine. I think my daughter's smiling. So let's invest. What has God instructed us to do for the reconciliation with Him? He established the sacrificial instructions in the desert and later in Jerusalem. And that was for a time. Through reading Scripture, God gives us instructions, as my friend Randy used to say, not to be confused with suggestions. Through His Redeemer for us, Yeshua HaMashiach, amen. In the writings part of our Scripture, we read in Daniel chapter 9 and 15, verse 1 and 15 and through 24, that He fasted and prayed and prophesied for restoration. We may even try to do good works for reconciliation. I know a lot of people do. I find myself wanting to do good works. And I struggle sometimes, am I doing good works to feel good, or I'm doing good works because I want my action to be in faith? Well, if anybody else does that, you're not alone. But I try to fall forward toward God instead of walking around on my heels and falling backwards. In Romans chapter 2, verses 5 through 10, we read that a stubbornness and unrepentant heart, we are storing up anger for ourselves. God will pay back according to our deeds. God disciplines those He loves. We read in John chapter 6, verse 28 through 29, here's what the work of God is, to trust in the one who He sent. So what can we do? Where can we get perfect, reliable advice for reconciliation? One of my wife's favorite verses, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. Trust in Adonai with all your heart. Do not rely on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will level your paths. So what do we do with these instructions, and how do we apply it? In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 through 14, a final word when all has been heard, fear God and keep His mitzvah. For this applies to all mankind. God will bring every deed into judgment, including everything that is hidden, whether it is good or evil. And that was from Shlomo, from Solomon, who had everything. He had wisdom. He had, gracious, many wives. He had wealth. He had respect. He had really everything. And all he asked for was wisdom from God. And he lifted up. He let his flesh control him. And he let women get into his lives and probably other things and helped and caused him to fall away from the Lord. And so at the end of the day, he's writing Ecclesiastes and he says, it's all for naught because we need to trust God and we need to love God. So he knows. It's good advice. To keep the Shabbat and keep it holy, as we read in Exodus chapter 20, to not neglect our congregational meetings, as we read in Hebrews, to not worry about anything, but make your requests known to God, as we read in Philippians chapter 4. He has an offer for us. Perhaps some of you pray often, others may rarely pray. But in James 5, we read that we should pray for ourselves, others who are ill, for forgiveness, even for miracles like Eliyahu. Hope can be hard in tough circumstances, and we are encouraged to pray. Do you struggle with your prayers? Be encouraged and bold as we read in James. Ask the Lord, trust, doubting in nothing. Perhaps you need to enter into a new relationship with God. Perhaps you need to return to a relationship with God. Some of us have stopped praying to God because of our circumstances, selfishness, apathy, entitlement, attitude, or maybe resentment or depression. Some of us don't know how to pray. Yeshua taught us his Talmudim how to pray in Matthew chapter 6, believing that he instructing us to prioritize first things first and allow God to work in our situation. Let's focus on him. At the beginning of this message, I read about trust, hope, and love. What do these words mean to you? What is your motivational response? I looked up a definition from the world. Trust is firm belief in the integrity, ability, or character of a person or thing, confidence or reliance, the condition and resulting obligation of having confidence placed in one. Hope is to wish for a particular event that one considers possible, to have confidence and trust, to desire and consider possible. Love is a strong feeling of affection and concern toward another person, as that arising from kinship or close friendship, a feeling of devotion or adoration toward God. I often think of love as something not that I feel, but as something that I'm giving. I'm not always so successful with that, but I know that to be true. So perhaps you're struggling tonight with love, like we all do. Perhaps God brought you to this service to express his love for you, a love that overcomes your personal history. We're lost without his perfect love. A love that endures, forgives, and restores. The Bible tells us that love covers a multitude of sins and that God loves compassion and mercy. So when he shows us mercy, we can turn and show mercy to others, pay it forward. Love for others, endurance toward others, hope for others, intercessory prayer for others, like Moshe did. It seems that time is passing us by way too fast. We can feel lost in the shovel, looking for our place. Well, you can feel safe in these trying times, and you can make a difference in these trying times. You can use your natural talents and skills for good. You can be all that God created you to be, as we read in Psalm chapter 139. We cannot escape him. He is familiar with all our ways. He fashioned our inmost being, and we are awesomely made. When Eli decided to come quite a bit early, my wife would pray that prayer that God would just make him like Adam, that he would just continue to knit his body together, because he was going to be born way too soon, and his lungs weren't developed, and here he is. He has great set of lungs on him now. Amen. As we are reading this weekly Torah portion, as we see quickly that God intends to fulfill his covenant that he made to Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Is that okay, Rabbi? In Exodus chapter 6, verse 2 through 4, and we see it continue to this day in Israel's restoration of the front pages. I would challenge you to believe that what has happened in the past is happening today as well. Things that are happening in Israel, we might argue they're happening in America, and you can read some Rabbi Kahn books about that, which I think we have in the gift shop. And so in conclusion, if you're Jewish, it is clear in this week's Torah portion that God hears your cry and moves with compassion and love to hear you, to reach you, to deliver you so that you may dwell within him. As for me, a Gentile, and others like me, we are grafted into Israel, as Shaul writes in Romans chapter 11. Through Yeshua HaMashiach, we are one new man. Perhaps you want to restore your relationship with God. You might be thinking that Yeshua just may have been the promised Messiah. We have a friend that just said, I've been thinking that I think Yeshua may be the Messiah that we've been waiting on. That Israel is waiting for, and you want to know more. Well, we're praying for you. We may not have met you yet, but we're praying for you and would love to talk with you. So if you're ready to believe that Yeshua is a promised Messiah, you can do that right now. If y'all would just close your eyes in prayer. If you would like to know Yeshua more, if you'd raise your hand, you'd put it right back down. And those on the video that are watching this, there's a number, I believe, at the bottom of the screen that you can call. Colin, we would love to talk to you. We'd love to pray with you and tell you more about Yeshua, your Yeshua. You can choose life and be set free from the bondage like we read about tonight. You can open your eyes now. Perhaps you can see the relevance from this Torah portion and what you see in the world today. Cry out to him right now, and he will hear you and can deliver you because he loves you, wants to have an amazing relationship with you, restore it with you, the relationship that he always intended. Oh, I shared this verse with me this morning, and I'll close with this. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. You are from God, children, and you have overcome them, because greater is he who is in the world. Than greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Shalom. Shalom.
Oh, my God.